I Am an American by Ron Kean. Kira Dixon, choir director at Christopher High School in Gilroy, California, commissioned Ron Kean to compose music to honor her maternal Japanese-American grandparents, Eiko Hayashi Shimizu, pictured right with her brother, Fred Hayashi, who were forcibly relocated to Camp Jerome, Arkansas during World War II.
One may ask, why not call these camps internment camps? Internment camps is a euphemism that minimizes a tragic time in American history. President Franklin Roosevelt called the relocation sites concentration camps. Camps that were designed specifically for the systematic murder of people delivered en masse by the Holocaust trains are called death camps.
Says the composer, I am of Jewish descent. I lived around the world for 10 years, growing up as a U.S. military dependent. This included 4 years in Tokyo, Japan. America, to me, is a land that encompasses many religions, cultures, and peoples. As someone who has felt the roots of both his ancestry and his country, I seek to honor those who also came to this country for a belief in a better way of life, for themselves and for their children.
It is our desire to shed light on why Japanese immigrants came to America. In their own words, their love of the land, love of this country, love of family, their experience of being unconstitutionally imprisoned, their quest to right this wrong, and their contributions to America. Let us now shed light on this dark chapter of American history by telling the story through photographs and through music.
Farmers in Japan suffered severe economic hardships during the 1880s due to a huge increase in taxes. Thousands lost their lands. Many also suffered from hunger. There was a shortage of workers in Hawaii and on the west coast of America due to the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882. The Emperor of Japan, for the first time, allowed people to leave their home islands. From 1885 to 1924, about 180,000 Japanese immigrants came to the United States through Angel Island in San Francisco Bay.
Immigrant descendants Konike grew many fruits, sugar beets, and vegetables in the West. It is estimated that 60% of all crops grown in the West were grown by Japanese American farmers. They took the volcanic and marine deposit landed soils that were like the soils of Japan and revolutionized strawberry farming. Kira Dixon's grandfather, Roy Shimizu, farthest right in the photo, along with his brothers, invented the strawberry basket used by the Wayne Basket Company in San José, California.
December 7th, 1941. This sign was displayed on a Japanese-American owned business in Oakland, California, one day after the horrific bombing of Pearl Harbor. This sign helped to define what it means to be an American.
Thank you. A few months after the attack on Pearl Harbor, the telephone rings. Hello, this is President Roosevelt speaking. Now, as you may know, we're at war with Japan, so I'm going to have to put you and your family in care. That phone call never came, but the effect was the same, and 3 years later, when the president died, we were still in camp. Lawson, Pusau, Inada. A distinguished poet interned as a child at a Machi camp in Granada, Colorado.
The attack intensified long simmering feelings of fear and prejudice towards Japanese immigrants and their descendants. Influential columnist Walter Lippmann warned without any evidence that everyone of Japanese descent living in America was a possible spy. Coincidentally, one of the most popular songs of this time was Don't Fence Me In by Cole Porter. And then...
Democracy across the It is not possible to make an accurate calculation of the value of property and potential income lost by the inmates. Estimates range from millions to many billions of dollars. When the government finally had to move out the last inmates in 1946, primarily the elderly and the destitute, they were given $25 and a train or bus ticket. Most chose to return to the West Coast, where they often found situations even more difficult than life in the camp.
The telephone rings. Hello, this is President Reagan speaking. I want to formally apologize for your illegal incarceration. The imprisonment of Japanese Americans was a mistake. Here we admit a wrong.
That phone call did come. This apology was given on August 10th of 1988. On October 9th of 1990, a ceremony was held to present 9 elderly Japanese Americans with the government's first redress checks of $20,000 each. It was not until 1991 to 1993 that payments to the remaining survivors took place. More than 82,000 received redress. America finally acknowledged her fault.
These reparations and the acknowledgement of the wrongdoing helped to restore the honor from having lost their homes, their land, and for being in prison for many years. Most thought that restoring honor was more important than reparations. There are more positive outcomes. Thousands of DC became interpreters and translators in the military intelligence service during World War II. Major General Willoughby, Assistant Chief of Staff of the Far East Command, estimated that they saved 1 million American lives and shortened the war by 2 years.
There are many stories of internees returning home to discover that their neighbors maintained their homes and lands while they were imprisoned. The Civil Liberties Act of 1988, sponsored by Congressman Norman Mineta, offered a blueprint for other American communities seeking justice. These include reparations to the 9 survivors of the 1923 Rosewood Massacre in Florida, preventing American Muslims from being attacked and persecuted after 9/11.
And an apology to the people of Hawaii in 1993 for the overthrow of their kingdom in 1893. So why does all of this matter? Could this happen again today? Are we doing what's right to preserve our treasured freedom? There's a saying in Japanese culture, kodomo no tamini, which means for the sake of the children. It is the legacy we're handing down to our children and to the nation to say that you can make this mistake, but you also have to correct it. And by correcting it, hopefully not to repeat it again.
America is a great nation, but many Americans have, at one time or another, been marginalized or persecuted. If we continue to confront and correct our wrongs, we can make an even better America for our children and our children's children.